time with Yontif.
Zoom in, man.
I stand before you today, honored and humble, as I was asked to fly in from Bozeman today and share with you the story of our daughter, Zisi. There are better people that I believe are suited for this honor, David Leib and Shelley, who work tirelessly to care for Shluchim's children, my daughter, Zisi, who has endured so much and at such a young age, and my wife, Chavi, who with love that is immeasurable and incomprehensible, devotes day in and day out to care not only for our shluchas, not only for our three kindalach, but specifically for Zisi and her special needs. Before I share with you Zisi's story, the story of our family, I want you to know that I still remember the moment that I got the call with Zisi's diagnosis, how frightened I was to use the word special needs, and how I wanted to keep it hush-hush. Bozeman, Montana, for those of you that have been there, is a town of thoughtful people, and so it wasn't them that I was scared of. It wasn't any particular person. I was scared to face it myself. Is it indeed real, I asked myself? Do I, Chaim Scholbrook, have a child that is now labeled to be special needs? I remember telling Chavi how unsure I am to use the term. It took time, quite some time, till I realized that it wasn't a flaw, and I don't care about ignorant perceptions. Zisi does have special needs, and Hashem only gives those children to special parents who are infused with strength and courage to raise them with love, dignity, and super TLC. I remember making my first phone call to my cousin Yisroel Willow, he probably doesn't even remember, and casually asking him, if a shliach calls Yalde Shluchi Rebbe, is everything discreet? Are the people running it trustworthy with keeping a secret? He didn't know that I was calling about myself, but he assured me that Yalde was extremely professional, permeated with so much sensitivity and care, so I made my first phone call to Shelly. I remember trying to articulate our situation, stumbling on my own words, repeating myself a few times, and in my heart hoping that they don't think I'm needy, that they don't think I'm a loser, and they don't question my integrity. You see, I have to explain. Amongst my friends and colleagues, for whatever reason unbeknown to me, I have a reputation of being a good fundraiser. They say Chaim Scholl lives in a very small city, he's not in any crazy debt, and even raises funds from non-Jews. In truth, I have to admit, I have a certain affinity for fundraising. The success of it gives me a healthy adrenaline. And for my Chabad house, my shluchas, I believe in no uncertain terms that it's a Zvulun Yisachar partnership, and I don't seek donors, but I seek partners. But to raise money for myself, for my own family, for our daughter, what am I, a beggar? Did being a shliach mean that I'm now a shmata? It's tough, very tough, yet in the face of darkness, while schlepping from doctor to doctor, from therapy to therapy, Yalde Shluchi Arev is a bright light. An organization that not only supports children with special needs, but their siblings and parents, and do so without making you feel inferior, but more like a brother or sister helping out their very own family. I agree, even though I'm a Brook and talking about personal sensitive issues is not very common to us, I agree to share with you our personal story, including some very personal aspects of our journey, because I stand before you this evening hoping to be a voice, not just for the Brook family in Montana, but a voice for the hundreds of shluchim and shluchis out there who at this very moment as I stand here tonight are sitting at home doing their very best with every fiber of their being to raise a child with special needs. They're trying to figure out if they can afford more cleaning help, if they can get a babysitter for a few more hours, or wondering how their marriage will survive the life Hashem has bestowed upon them. They feel lonely. Lonely, like Chavi and I feel on occasion, wondering if anyone really gets it, wondering how we will make it, and thanking Hashem that at least David Leib and Shelley are just a text message away, and that you, their supporters, are here to support their amazing work. Let me tell you about Zisi, but you'll have to indulge, and I have to give you a little bit of background. On Chaf Beis Adar, Tavshin Samach Vav, March 22, 2006, just over 10 years ago, I married Chavi Block of San Antonio, Texas. Like all our peers, the next thing on the agenda was to begin building our very own family. 1 year later, on the morning after our first anniversary, Chav Gimel Adar Tavshin Samach Zayin, just after Purim of 2007, we boarded a flight from Newark Airport to Bozeman, Montana, with my parents, siblings, and a couple of close friends waving from across the security checkpoint. We said goodbye as we embarked on our life's mission to the Yidden of Montana, a place that had no traditional Yiddishkeit for at least 150 years. Shlichus has lots of uncertainty, especially in untouched Montana. But with all our concerns, deep down, somewhere very deep down, we were certain that with the Rebbe's brachas and Hashem's help, sooner than later, the Eibishter would bench us with Zara Chaya V'Kayoma. Our shlichus took off, but behind closed doors, Chavi and I began to worry. What's with children? Why is Chavi not pregnant? Is it me? Is it her? Is it both of us? What should we do? Bozeman is a picturesque place with amazing quality of life, but what's it all worth without a family? One particular Rav here in the Heights kept on telling us, Farts feyor darfim ish daiginen, but I didn't buy it. Later that year, we started visiting highly recommended doctors in New York, and eventually with the help of an amazing, amazing organization, Boinei Olam, led by my dear friend, Reb Shlomo Buchner, who's here with me tonight. We were introduced to the top medical practitioners in the field of infertility. Finally, on Erev Shavuos of 2008, just 2 years after our marriage, after undergoing a medical procedure, the doctor said to us, and I quote, and you'll never forget those words, you are not having biological children, there's nothing else to do. As you can imagine, it was devastating, heartbreaking, and we felt truly hopeless. I was 26, Chavi was 23, and no kids? How could Hashem do that to us? How does one proceed? After Yom Tov, we headed back home. We were in a daze. Yes, we believed that Le'yazev is Tzoy Marisa, that the Rebbe cares for his shluchim. We continued to daven, hoping for a miracle. But in Poel Mamish, the reality on the ground didn't feel that way, and the loneliness was setting in. We felt like spiritual schizophrenics. One day I'm on board with total faith in Hashem, and the others I questioned everything. I was angry at the Eibishter, angry every time I saw a baby stroller, and I didn't know if we'd ever overcome. We thought about adoption, but who ever heard of adoption? Are they really your own kids? Is it just a mechanism to allow us to play house and look like everyone else? Or is it really a family? The solitude of the next 15 months was shreklich, unbearable. We didn't tell anyone in our Chabad House community what we were going through. We were just not close enough with them at that point to share our heartbreak. And even amongst our own family, we didn't talk much. Our siblings knew, our best friends knew, but it was taboo as no one really had solutions. And sympathy, rachmanus, wasn't what we were looking for. Like with most challenges in life, anyone who hasn't experienced it personally doesn't really get it. At the Kinnus HaShluchim that fall, while sitting in Beis Shmuel, I ran into an old friend from Moscow. For the first time, I opened up about our situation. He was visibly shocked and expressed genuine brotherhood that morning. For the first time, I didn't feel so alone. Before we parted ways, I asked him, almost jokingly, think about us, if a baby ever comes your way and there's a possibility for adoption. That night, I attended the Kinnus session at Wingate, and they showed an unpublicized gem video in which the Rebbe encourages two women to adopt babies. I'll never forget how I sat sitting next to Rabbi Zippel from Utah, staring at the screen in a state of ecstasy and wanting to scream to all the shluchim in the room about the Hashgacha Pratis that just took place this year when we're in the midst of the crazy process, a direct message from our beloved Rebbe guiding us in the right direction. It was a moment of light in a tunnel of darkness. I called Chavi immediately to share in my delight. However, the months passed. We looked into adoptions in Israel and Ukraine and the US, but nothing panned out. We learned from the experts in the field of all the intricacies involved in the process, which is so overwhelming. The legalities and costs seemed impossible to deal with. We learned all about the process and what the possibilities are and aren't. We had friends like Zelig, who's a Litvish Yid from Cleveland, who devoted himself to our success with heart and soul, and Shia, a Belzer Chassid from Borough Park, who really worked tirelessly to find us a baby. But 16 months had passed since the Erev Shavuos procedure, and I died in Loy Noishanu. During these months, our shluchas kept growing, Baruch Hashem. Bozeman has a high birth rate, and it seemed like the whole town was pushing strollers. In addition, our beloved siblings began with the phone calls. You know, I'm Shaul, I just want you to know what we're expecting. We were still alone in our own cocoon, crying internally and sometimes externally, wondering why us? Tfilas HaShalom, some unique ground-up stone that my mother sent me that I'll be Kabbalah. If you drink it, you become fertile. 5 different alternative health gurus and ideas. You named the Sgula an idea, and we tried it, but nothing doing. You know, we always hear a shluchim, a hanash, about people keeping tires of mishpacha and being blessed with children. But a Lubavitcher couple who drive 7 hours each and every month to Salt Lake City, Utah, to the mikveh, they aren't blessed? Hashem's justice system didn't seem just at all. Now for the good news. On Ches Elul, August 28th, 2009, a little baby girl was born in a slum hospital outside of Moscow in Russia. A Yiddish mama gave birth to a child in her seven and a half months into her pregnancy. The baby weighed about 3 pounds and was not in good health. Mom was scared and shocked as this pregnancy was unplanned. Hospitalized for over a month, hooked to a respirator and undergoing several surgeries, she managed to survive the Russian medical care. She still had a long road to full recovery. The doctors encouraged the mom to take the baby to America for medical evaluation. Bashgacha Pratis Mamash, unquestionable divine providence. The woman in Moscow called my friend, yes, the same friend who I had spoken to at Beis Shmuel back at the Kinnus. While mom tried to figure out her life, the Rebbe Shluchim, my dear friend, and his amazing Eishes Chayil, with total Mesiras Nefesh, took this child into their home and temporarily cared for our little Neshamla. Mom finally listened to the doctors and took her baby for medical evaluation in the States. The Shluchim, both husband and wife, got on the plane with her to fly to the United States to be at her side. Once she was here, she became very clear, and it became very clear in her mind that she was going to give the baby up for adoption. Our friends couldn't believe it. They worked with her and spoke with her about the ramifications of her decision, but she was adamant to give up her baby. At that point, I'll never forget where I was sitting. My friend called me and said, "I'm Shaul, you remember the conversation you had at the last year's Kinnus? Are you still interested in adoption?" After overcoming immense challenges, finally on the brightest Tuesday morning of our lives, Yom Gimel Shehuf Baboy Kitoiv Chav Gimel Cheshvan, sitting in a gas station in a small town in New Jersey, we got the call that was almost 4 years in the making. It was like getting a call directly from the Eibishter, telling us in the words of Paul Harvey, "Now you know the rest of the story." It was the adoption agency. "Rabbi Brooke, you and your wife can come now and get your beautiful baby." We did. It was that beautiful morning that Chaya made me an Abba and Chavi a Mami. The gift of adoption is something most people can't relate to, but it's an experience like no other. While I don't know what it's like to have biological children, I do know how amazing it is to have an adoptive child. When it rains, it pours. And just a few months after Chaya, I received a call from a shliach in New Jersey about another potential adoption. When I shared with my mother, Aleha Shalom, that this was in the works, she wondered out loud, "Why the rush for a second one so quickly, 11 months later?" I said, "Ma, I thought we don't believe in family planning." She laughed and was on board for the second coming. So on Shmini Atzeres, our second daughter, Zizi, was born, but because she was a few weeks earlier, we were caught off guard. So on Matzah Yontif, my brother Yanki and sister Mushki went to pick up our baby at the hospital, and we met our Zizi, and not many of you can say this about your children, we met our Zizi for the very first time at Enterprise Rental Car at Newark Airport. 2.5 years later, with the help of another wonderful couple of shluchim, we adopted our beautiful boy, Meni. Chaya, Zizi, and Meni have given us so much, and each one of them is gifted in their own way, but today I'd like to focus on Zizi. On a beautiful Sunday morning in the fall of 2011, just after Zizi's first birthday, she was sitting in her high chair while I fed her breakfast, and suddenly her head dropped and she started experiencing a seizure. I'd never seen one before close up, but it was apparent enough that I screamed on the top of my lungs to Chavi, who was upstairs. In pajamas, with Javi holding Zizi tight, Chaya in the back seat, and me driving like a maniac, we were in the ER at Bozeman Deaconess Hospital within 6 minutes of the seizure. I immediately called two Reifim Yedidim, two wonderful Jewish docs who we know in town, as well as Zizi's angel-like pediatrician. Two of them came to the hospital within 30 minutes, and the ER doc started blood work and x-rays and CT scans, and they found nothing. Her brain didn't show any of the expected abnormalities associated with epilepsy. They said that sometimes kids get a seizure and it never comes back. We were given an emergency shot to have with us at all times in case it happens again and it doesn't stop, you should immediately inject her. Of course, within this time, I also called Abba Refson at the oil to put in her name immediately for a bracha. But as time passed, it seemed that everything was fine. She was a bit slow, learning to walk, learning to speak. She had some other challenges, but not drastic enough for us to realize that something major isn't right and our life will be changing forever. We schlepped to Billings, that's our big city, to a neurologist who flies in once a month to see children. He is certain, he tells us, that Zizi's developmental issues are all behavioral, not neurological, and that the seizures and her slow development are unrelated. It didn't make sense to us, and every day or two, Zizi would have a meltdown. So you all say to yourself, big deal, all kids have meltdowns. True, but Zizi's meltdowns lasted an hour and a half, where she blacked out, and she couldn't hear us, she wasn't consolable, and her crying would disrupt the entire household. Javi and I finally figured it out and had it down to a science. One of us would take her and hold her in a closed room so she doesn't disturb the other kids. We knew this was not behavioral, something wasn't right, and we were determined to figure it out. The summer of 2012, and it was the summer of 2012, and she still had two more grand mal seizures. And now we're used to these procedures, you know, we're used to it, but not knowing what it's really about was very scary. Should we put her on meds? Is it genetic? Did her biological parents have it? These are all questions you don't know when you adopt a child, and we were left in the dark. Montana is so far from the remarkable medical facilities that the larger cities have that we were unsure where to go. A fellow shlucha and friend who also has a child with special needs told Javi of a place in southern New Jersey she'd taken her son for neurological evaluation. Thanks to Rabbi and Mrs. Mendy Mangel, the angels of Cherry Hill, who knew a few of the doctors, in November of 2014, just a short 2 years ago, oh, not less than 2 years ago, we were able to secure a 3-day evaluation appointment in New Jersey to assess our beautiful Zizi. It cost a fortune, there's no insurance coverage, but with the help of friends and family, Javi traveled with Zizi for this evaluation. The primary neurologist, a Hungarian doctor who knew Chabad back in Hungary, was amazing, and via a host of tests, he concluded without a shadow of doubt that Zizi doesn't sleep more than a half a night, she's never rested, her brain is unstable, and her crying episodes are small seizures which are absolutely impacting her development. Heading back to Montana, the docs wanted Zizi to undergo genetic testing to figure out her particular form of epilepsy. Indeed, the wonderful new pediatric neurologist in Billings performed a spinal tap, and to the dismay of the insurance company, they also performed a $22,000 genetic test at the Shonir Hospital in Helena, and both confirmed that Zizi has a rare genetic disorder called GLUT1. It has nothing to do with gluten. It's just called GLUT1. It was clear like day that Zizi Brooke, the special neshama, had a disorder that only 500 people worldwide have ever been diagnosed with. What is GLUT1? I quote from the medical world, glucose transporter type 1 deficiency syndrome is a genetic disorder that impairs brain metabolism. Glucose isn't transported properly into the brain, leaving it starving for the energy it needs to grow and function. The impaired glucose transport associated with GLUT1 deficiency causes an array of symptoms which may vary considerably from one patient to another. Some signs and symptoms may include seizures, movement disorders, speech and language disorders, and developmental delays. There is no cure for GLUT1 deficiency. The only thing you can do is put her on a ketogenic diet. When you read this on Wikipedia or WebMD or wherever you try to Google, the first thing you can say is, oh God, now what? In addition to speech therapy, occupational therapy, physical therapy, in addition to the medication she was taking for the seizures, what else can we do? What is a ketogenic diet? What are we up against? A ketogenic diet is a high fat, it's not a diet to go to lose weight. It's a diet that's high fat, moderate protein, and low carbs that causes the body to produce and burn ketones for fuel in the absence of glucose. In English, that means you don't get your energy from sugar like most of us, you get your energy from fat. And so a typical meal looks like hot dogs, it has to be weighed on a scale. And if I had to sum it up, a ketogenic diet in English would translate as a pain in the you-know-what. ZC can only eat meals that are specially prepared and measured weekly by Tavi. Only certain ingredients are allowed and doesn't include food that kids normally like. She can't ever eat out in a restaurant or anyone else's home. And when we travel, whether nationally or internationally, we must bring her meals along. She travels every 3 months to Colorado's Children's Hospital in Aurora, where they monitor her progress with lots of blood work, psychoanalysis, and testing galore. Because of Zizi's condition, we placed her in a really good Montessori school in Bozeman. It's not an easy decision for a shliach and shluchah to decide to send their kids to a local school that isn't necessarily Jewish. She's excelling in the school and has made great strides in her vital skills. The school is very expensive and was doable only thanks to the efforts of Yaldi Shluchi Rebbe. David Leib, working together with my dear friend Binyamin, brought together a group of my classmates, many of whom didn't know until this very moment that I was the recipient of those funds, to put together the funds to pay for ZC schooling. It's just one of the countless examples of positive life changes in the lives of Shluchim's families that would never be possible without the love and support of Yaldi. On the bright side, Baruch Hashem, in the last year since Zizi's been on the diet, she has progressed amazingly and is developing beautifully. Just a month ago, she even went diaper-free. She's finally potty trained at the young age of almost 6 years old. In addition, Zizi was chosen to represent Montana as the champion child of 2016 on behalf of the Miracle Network of Hospitals. It's a big Kiddush Hashem in our state and gives us the amazing opportunity to bring awareness to her condition and hopefully bring about eventually a cure. We don't know what the long-term effects of GLUT1 are. We don't know exactly how Zizi will develop as a teenager or what she will be like in adulthood. No one knows. GLUT1 is so new that no one knows the answer to our many questions. What we do know is that Hashem entrusted us with three beautiful neshamas who teach Chavi and I every day how precious life is and make us better people, better parents, and better shluchim. I never signed up to be an adoptive father, and I never signed up to be a father of a special child. But now that God has signed me up for it, I've come to realize that He knows just what He's doing. I don't understand some days what He's up to. I really don't. But I know somewhere deep down that He's got it right. Chavi and I struggle reconciling all that we have to put up with. Standing here tonight, seeing such a tremendous, huge crowd reminds us both that we are not alone. Zizi's brother Manny and sister Chaya are not alone, and of course Zizi herself is not alone. You are all there for us and with us. You know and care about our challenges and the challenges of my colleagues. The Rebbe gifted the world with shluchim and shluchas, and He gifted the shluchim and shluchas with partners such as yourself, who with love, compassion, and genuine concern support our shluchas and our family lives. When we walked into the infertility treatment back in 2008, the mashgiach for the infertility treatment from a time, Rabbi Jacobowitz, handed me a magnet. It said, Yidin, Zaitzach Nishmiyayish, Vabiteach Bahashem Chesed Yisevenu. I try to live with that trust every day. I'd like to conclude with a heartfelt prayer that all those from Anash, Shluchim, and Klal Yisrael who are experiencing challenges with a child or otherwise, who know the pain of Tzar Gidul Bonin physically or spiritually, should merit to go min ha-metzer el ha-merchav and have the inner strength to deal with their particular journey, and be zoyche to Yeshua Hashem, which is always keheref ayin, l'chaim, and thank you.